We have the opportunity right now to do what we just sang. Saying here in our weakness, you'll find us falling before your throne. You may want to do that this morning. You may want to fall before the throne of the one we have been singing to you right now. Right where you are, you may want to stand, kneel. You may want to come to the altar, but let us fall before the throne. Our Father knows those who need a touch from him this morning. And I believe if we're honest, we all need a touch from our Lord and our Heavenly Father God this morning. So would you join me in prayer as we go before the throne of grace? Heavenly Father, we do, no matter what our position is here, in our hearts we fall before the throne of grace. Because of who you are, because you are our Father, for those who have received your Son, Jesus Christ, and the salvation and the forgiveness of sins that he provides. And maybe some are bowing right now, or to confess a sin or sins that where we want to be forgiven for. We're going to leave from this sanctuary today pure, as your word tells us to be. We want to confess right now, Father, as you already know, but we openly confess it to you that we have not been what you have asked us to be. And Lord, there are some like Paul, we really tried, God. We really tried. And the things I wanted to do, I just didn't do. And I ask your forgiveness for that, Lord. And Father, the things that I didn't want to do. Lord, thank you that you're a God of forgiveness, a God of mercy, a God of grace, a God that your children can come to you confidently and boldly. And even as we're praying, we can sense or feel your feather-covered wings coming around us as we seek refuge in you. We seek wisdom and help for this coming day, this coming week. Lord, to be open to doing those things that you ask us to do. To be open to give up those things that you want to take from us, Lord, so that we have an even more intimate relationship with you, Lord. So many things and people, even within our own family, Lord, depending on our ability to be able to pray and to pray confidently and to pray boldly and to pray with the certainty that our hearts are clear and open, and that line of communication to you, Father God, is reaching from our hearts, our voice, and our mouth into heaven. Lord, we need to know that, and so we ask for it, Lord. And Father, as you look at the hearts that are bowed here, the knees that are bowed, the heads that are bowed, the eyes that are closed, Lord, we thank you that you know what we need even before we ask, but because we assume this posture, because we come before you, the throne of grace, we know that you hear us. And we know that what we ask for, God, if we do not doubt, we know that you have something very special for us. But right now, Father God, there may be some that just need hope. They just need peace. The weather, the sin, the circumstances, COVID, the loss of a job, grief, all those things have just weighed us down, Lord, and there's some feel that we're sinking. So God, we reach up and we take your hand as you pull us up, and you pull us not only up, but you pull us to your heart, Lord. And we just thank you, Father God, for what you're going to do, because we have prayed, we've come before you as you've asked us to do. And Lord, we've come before you as we've wanted to do. But Father, we just praise you, because we know that there's an answer already on the way from heaven, and it will reach us at just that perfect time. Lord, help us to trust, help us to believe. And these are the things that we pray in the holy and precious name of Jesus Christ, the one who died for us. In his name we pray. Amen. God bless you, dear folks. Thank you. It's always good to go before the Lord in prayer at any time. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, and I hope that you do, I want you to turn to James chapter 1. We're going to be looking at James this morning as we continue our series in James. And as you're turning there, I just want to thank Kim Costello, who has been singing in our choir and blessing us and has blessed us with specials before. And she's going to be leaving back up to New York tomorrow. So we want to remember her in our prayers for safe travel. And yes, but no. So I know Bob is already up there and is waiting for her, but we're going to miss you, Kim. We just want to thank you for all that you do. And it's far more, not all of you know, but it's far more than Kim and Bob being here and Kim just singing up here. There's far more that they do for Pine Drive, even when they're up there in New York. And so we'll pray that soon, very soon, they'll come back to God's country and bless us again. Amen. Please give Kim a hug or a whatever before she leaves here today. Again, thank you. If you have your Bibles there, and I hope you do, you know, I've been thinking about this, and I mentioned, I think it was 2 weeks ago when I held up the Bible and said, that Bible that you're holding in your hands or on your lap there is full of power. It's full of dynamite. It's full of power of Almighty God. It's His roadmap. It's His inerrant word that He has given to us. Paul says it's the inerrant word. It's living and it's active and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. I want to issue a challenge to you, and I don't know who does and who doesn't. Obviously, I can see some, but I want to issue a challenge to you, maybe a challenge to some that are listening in to our service here today. I want to challenge you to bring your Bible to church. I want to challenge you to hold the power of Almighty God in your hand. And I'm not telling you to put it under your pillow and maybe by osmosis something will get in there. That's not what I'm talking about. But I just happen to believe that it is living and it's active and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. You know, one of the reasons I'm asking for this challenge is I was reading where a church was growing by leaps and bounds, and someone was looking for a Baptist church. And so they were at a business right across from the Baptist church, and the man went in and asked the proprietor, he said, I thought you told me that was a Baptist church over there. And the man says, well, it is a Baptist church. It's a very big Baptist church. It's a growing Baptist church. And the man said, well, it can't be a Baptist church because they're all carrying Bibles. True story. Because they're all carrying Bibles. If nothing else, if your neighbor sees you carrying your Bible out to the car, you know, who knows what God's going to do? And who knows, maybe I will say something that would just maybe tick your mind, and you say, where's that in here? I gotta find that. So I want to challenge you, carry your Bibles to church. Let me make it a little more specific. I challenge you to carry your Bible for the next 4 weeks to church. And if you really want to challenge, I want to challenge you to carry your Bible until we finish the book of James. It's a long time, but it's good to be in the Lord's house and in His Word. So let's take a look at James, and I want to talk to you this morning about indicators of true religion, This is part two of the series that we have done, and you've got your outline there with you. We may or may not finish the entire outline. We're going to be doing this part of this for this week and then the next 2 weeks. So what we don't talk about today or cover today, we'll cover in the weeks ahead, because this is so important. I want to remind you, this is James, that is the pastor of the church there in Jerusalem. And his people have not only been scattered, but there are those still there. And they're facing many of the things which bring grief and fear and anxiety into their hearts some of the things that we experience here today. And so I want to talk to you about the indicators of true religion this morning. I was reading a story. Again, a true story. Of course, everybody, I don't think there's anybody that can forget Hurricane Katrina, especially if you were there. But on August 31st of 2005, FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, and we were very familiar with FEMA during Harvey, although we chose not to participate with FEMA, and I think God has blessed us in ways that we may not have been blessed before. But anyhow, the director of FEMA, the regional director that was down there in Louisiana, his name was Marty Balmondi, and he emailed the director of FEMA up in Washington regarding the situation that he was encountering there in New Orleans immediately following Hurricane Katrina and all the effects that it had. We remember it from the television pictures, if you will. And this is what he wrote to the director of FEMA up in Washington. He said, "Sir, I know that you know the situation is past critical. Here are some things you might not know that I need to make you aware of. The hotels are kicking people out. Thousands are gathering in the streets here in New Orleans with no food and no water, and hundreds are still being rescued from their homes, some of them on their roofs." He said, "There are dying patients at DMAT. DMAT is the disaster medical assistance team. He said, there are dying patients at the DMAT tent. Estimates are many will die within hours. Evacuation is in progress. Plans are developing for the dome evacuation." Remember the Superdome, the New Orleans Superdome, and what happened there. And he said, "But the hotel situation is adding to the problem. We're out of food and running out of water at the dome. Plans are in work to address this critical need." And they said the FEMA staff... this message. He said, "Thanks for the update. Anything specific I need to do or to tweak from up here?" That was his response. People were dying by the thousands, out of food, out of water, being thrown out, kicked out of the hotels. And the director's insensitive response is a mirror to many of the churches in America today, I believe. You remember Paul or James, as we were looking at last week, was talking about we look in a mirror and then we walk away and we forget what we look like. And I think this is what we're going to see here in our text this morning of the kind of religion that God wants us to have. In Matthew, Jesus said when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, and because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into this harvest field." And this is what James says in our text this morning that I want us to read here in just a minute. He's saying we are not to be like the world. We are not to be and to have a response like the director of FEMA had. Such a cold response because everything was cool where he was and where others were that weren't in New Orleans that day. We're not to say to people that come into our church or people that knock on our door for food or for water or maybe even some money for gasoline, we're not to say, thanks for the update. We'll pray for you. How often we use that excuse, we will pray for you. And James is telling his people, that's not the way that Jesus Christ wants his churches to be. So if you have your Bibles there this morning, I want you to see this extremely insightful passage that I believe it is insightful for the faith family. I believe it's insightful for our nation. And it's a choice that that we have as Christians. Are we going to live the religion that we want to live that makes us comfortable, or are we going to live the type of religion that Jesus Christ wants us to live? And that's a decision that not only a church, but each of us, each individual has to make that decision. So read along with me, if you will, in James chapter 1, and let me pick it up in verse 26. These stakes are really high here in what James is talking about and what I want us to look at this morning. Extremely high, if you will. And listen to what he says in verse 26. He said, if anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit. In your version, some of your versions you may have a look after. I want to address that, to visit, to look after in just a moment. He said, pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. That means polluted. Keep us from being polluted. We've got polluted water in many places right now, so we have to boil the water. And that's what he's talking about. Stay away from being polluted from the world. And he said in chapter 2, verse 1, he said, my brother, show no partiality or favoritism as you hold the faith in your Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand over there, or you sit down at my feet, have you not then made distinctions or actually discriminated? Have you not discriminated against that person among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Catch the words here that James is talking about, talking to his church, talking to his people, while there are hundreds of them perhaps out there without jobs, maybe without food, without water, maybe being in prison. Who knows what's going on there at that time? And he said, but you, in verse 6, have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court, are they not the ones who blaspheme or slander the honorable name by which you were called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin. Did you catch that? If you show favoritism or partiality to someone who walks into your church or into your home or wherever, they said you are sinning. This is God's word saying you are sinning. Verse 10, he said, for whoever keeps the whole law all but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery, but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. Heavenly Father God, open our hearts, open our minds. Lord, there are so many people around us hurting, so many hungry, so many lost. Father, show us in each one of our hearts today what it is that you would have us take from your living word, the word that you penned from heaven through many men such as us. And we pray these things in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. I talked to you last week about the marks of true and acceptable religion. It's there in your outline. And again, I hope you have that outline out, and I hope you fill it out and keep it in your Bible this coming week. But the first one we looked at, we said there were four marks, four distinctions or indicators of true religion. And the one we talked about last week is controlled speech. True and acceptable religion to God is controlled speech that displays a change heart. Remember, I talked about that last week, how for many of us, once we received Jesus Christ, our language changed. For some, it changed immediately. For others, it changed over a period of time. But our language changed, and the things that we were speaking out of our mouth, we knew was coming from our heart, and God was changing our heart so that those words that came out there built people up rather than tearing people down, or lifted the name of Jesus Christ up rather than using the name of Jesus Christ or God in a derogatory or defaming fashion. And we said that the tongue is the test of true religion. James said there, as we looked at it, if you speak in a way that doesn't honor the glory of God, he said, if you speak that way, again, talking to Christians, he said, your religion is what? He said, your religion's a shame. It's worthless. Take this to heart. If we speak against people or speak words that are not building people up or helping people, it said your religion is a shame, it's worthless, and the Bible says, James says, it deceives. So I want to talk about this second trait, if you will, or the second indicator of true religion, of the religion that God wants us to have. And let me just say that before we take a look at this, I know you know this, but I don't know if you think about it very often. We're just a heartbeat away from facing this one who wrote these words. Just a heartbeat away. For those of you who are 70 or 80 or 90 years old, you're really a heartbeat away from facing the one who we're talking about here, the one who has written these words. I know you do because I know you, if I can say it that way. You believe in the inerrant, infallible word of God, written by God himself through men, through the hands and the hearts of people that he called out to write this. So we need, as we're looking at James here, we need to really not just take notes, but we really need to pray about this. We need to contemplate what God is saying to us here. And the interesting thing, or the thing that God does is, since we're all in different places, spiritually and physically and otherwise, you know, God sends his word out just to where you are, to where you need. Maybe to kick it up another notch, maybe to pray more, to meditate more, whatever it may be. But take these seriously. So controlled speech, he says, displays a changed heart. And the second mark of true and acceptable religion here is sacrificial care for those in need. Those who are believers and followers of Jesus Christ, we have a sacrificial care for those in need. I wrote that word sacrificial there, very intentionally. And he said in verse 27, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction. And that word visit there in the New International Version, you may have the New some of you do have the New International Version, but that's a potent word that you can find if you look at it in the Hebrew language or the Greek language. That's a potent word that is used in the Old Testament in Exodus. It's used several times in Exodus. It's used in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, especially the first chapter, and then also in chapter 7, this word visit, the context of that. So throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, that word literally means look after. When you see someone who is in need, look after them. And I just say this again, I am so proud of what our deacons, your deacons, and others that I know have been doing this past week to make sure that our widows and some others that they're being taken care of in the midst of this storm. And so it just touches my heart because he says, look after. And you know what? If you look in that word, especially in Exodus and there in Luke and in other places in the New Testament, he's not only using that word look after, but it has the connotation of seek someone out. Don't miss that. Seek someone out. Okay, we all know, you've heard me say this 100 times already this morning, you know this. There are people who are hurting out there, people who still do not have water, people who are still affecting or suffering the effects of COVID and isolation and loneliness and when am I going to get my shot and when am I going to get my surgery and all these things. Well, the Bible says, God says, seek them out. They're out there, just seek them out. The fields are ripe for harvest. I don't have to tell you each person to go to. They're all around you. So look after them, seek them out, provide for them. It has the connotation of we, again, as a church, have the responsibility to seek them out and then to look after them and to help them, to care for them and to provide for them. And this describes, isn't this how it describes it, what God did for you and what God did for me? He sought us out and he came for us because he cared for us. And when he saw us and he called us and we received his call, he not only took care of us, he changed our heart and he provided for us. We are the most provided people in the world. Not just because we're Christians, but spiritually, as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ, we are, have been, and will be always provided for in the midst of whatever storm, hurricane, whatever comes into our life. And this is something that we need to hold. Here's the deal. Those people back there in that time didn't have insurance policies. Some of us aren't too worried about the effects last week, other than we were uncomfortable and cold maybe. But we know we've got insurance. Somebody's going to come through for us. They didn't have insurance. They didn't have any place where they could go to get food. There were no food lines. There were no water lines like there are here in Houston. They're going to provide food, going to fly water in, fly food. They didn't have that. They didn't have a gas fireplace to sit in front of to stay warm. They were out there on their own, and James was saying, they're out there, they're hurting, they're crying, they're dying. Seek them out because you're the church of God. You are the hands, the feet, and the voice of God. Seek them out. And whatever you have to do, sacrifice if time or money or whatever it is, but bring Christ into their heart. Bring Christ into their life. Hold them up, hold them, whatever it takes, let them know. I know we have one here, not here, but we have one in our church, sweet, sweet lady, and I know Brother John and Troy and others, Fred, have been working with her, but taking care of her son, who adult son, who is in need of care. Her pipe broke, and as many of you know, we can't get a plumber, can't get anybody out. No water, cold, all those kind of things. Well, praise God again. Some of our folks, some of our deacons have sought her out. And they are attempting to minister to her and to provide for her in whatever means that God will allow us to do. This is what he's talking about. These are widows. We have widows. These are widows. There are children that don't have a husband or don't have a mother. There are husbands that don't have wives, or a wife, or a wife that doesn't have a husband, and they're out there, they're hurting. There's no welfare programs. Back in that time that they could call upon the government was trying to persecute them, not to feed them, not to help them. So these people were desperate that James was writing to. In the reality, these were orphans and these were widows that were in need. They were in need. And there's a void there and many of you, some of you know this, there's a void there, a widow or a widower. When that wife or that husband is no longer there, there's that void there. Your life changes drastically. And I know there's brothers and sisters here in this room this morning, as well as those who may be listening in, who find themselves just as James is writing to people here. My husband's gone. My wife's gone. My children are gone. They're grown, and they have their own lives. How many times have you felt that or heard that? They've got their own lives to live. We just feel alone. We feel like, who can help me? People crying out for help. God says, my church will help you. James, write this down. My church will help you. And James says, these things that you're doing and these things that you're saying and these things that you're not doing for the hurting there, that's not the church of Jesus Christ. He said, and your religion is worthless. See, these are serious words from the inerrant word of God. I can't say that strong enough. And let me tell you, he's been talking to me. He's been talking to me as I prepare these messages. Sometimes I'm tempted to change a message to make it a little easier on myself. But this is God's word. And you're his church, and I'm his church. And I want to remind you, that this God we've been singing to, he's your defender. That's what the Word of God says. He's your defender. You know what that means? That means if you say something against my wife, I'm going to defend her. If somebody says something about your child, you're going to defend them. When somebody says something about you as a child of God, God is going to defend you. He's going to be your supporter. He's going to be your strength. He's going to be your ever-present help. And if that hurts you, he's going to pick you up and he's going to hold you. Lamb of God. Lambs. He's going to hold you. And for some, he even needs to press your head against his chest so that you can feel his heartbeat. I praise God that we have a God like that. I praise God that he has created a church like this, because many of the things that I'm saying here, you're doing. But not everybody that hears this message are doing that. And there are some that just need to be motivated to see the intensity and the seriousness of the Word of God, especially as it's being written here through James. Notice in chapter 20, or verse 27 again. Let me read that one more time. He said, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained or polluted from the word. I'm thankful God put that commandment in there. As I studied that and read about it and read some commentaries, I'm thankful. Because you know the reality is right now, at this very moment, there are millions of kids that are still living in orphanages. There are millions of kids that have no homes. There are millions of kids who, when they wake up in the morning, have no one to greet them. They just go to get a handout for food, maybe at the food line in their orphanage. There are millions of kids in America today, and they're right here, they're all around us, that when they go to sleep tonight, they'll have no mother, they'll have no father to tuck them into their bed and say, I love you. And when they awake in the morning, there'll be no mother there, no father there to give them a hug and say, have a great day at school. Don't forget to take your lunch. They're orphans. They're hurting. Some of you may support organizations, Feed the Children, Compassion International. I have a son a teenager from El Salvador that I've been supporting for many, many years now, and just heard from Compassion International because of COVID, because of all the effects that's taking place, that they're crying out for people to sponsor more children. They just don't have enough to sponsor them. $38 a month to help that child. This is what he's talking about here, sacrificial. There are people out there that we have to sacrifice for, if there's any way you can do that. And James says, this is not an option. Don't miss this. James says to his church, this isn't an option for you. As a Christian, you have an obligation to do this. It's your obligation, and you are going to be held accountable for this. And for the church to look after the orphans and the widows that are in distress. And he says, if you're not doing that, your religion is worthless. I don't know how this message is coming across to you this morning, but that's God's word. I don't want one day, perhaps soon and very soon, to face my God and him to look at me. Yeah, you were the pastor of Pine Drive Baptist Church, but let me tell you, your religion is worthless. Or to have Jesus say, go away, I never knew you. I know you dance for me. I know you preach for me. I know you sang for me. I know you deacon for me, but go away. I never knew you. Your religion was worthless, friends. Brothers and sisters in Christ, now is the time to change that. That's the reason that God's word is to be preached. If you need forgiveness, he forgive you right now. If you need to get active, you can do that right now. If you need to raise your hands and feet and voice and say, God, here they are. Use them as you want to use them, God. They're all yours. The time to do it is right now. And let me tell you, it's not the time to wait for the invitation. The time to do it, if this is touching you in any way, the time is to do it right now. And God bless you for all those of you who are doing this. And that's most of you, if not all of you. But you know some who perhaps are not. And then he said, we must not neglect them. I want you to turn very quickly. We're not going to get through this today, but that's okay. I want you to turn back to Psalm 68 for just a moment here. Psalm 68, and talking about we must not neglect these widows and these orphans and those people that are hurting. And listen to what David said in Psalm 68. Look at verse 5. He said, well, let me back it up to verse 4 to keep this into the context here. And he's talking about, he said, sing to God, sing praises to his name. See, he's talking about God. He says, lift up song to him who rides through the deserts. His name is the Lord. Exalt before him. And then listen to what he says about God. He said, the father of the fatherless and the protector of what? The protector of widows is God in his holy habitation. Verse 6, God settles the solitary in a home. I love the way the New International Version says that. He said, God sets the lonely in families. We are a family of God. God has set some of us, some of you who are lonely in his family, the family of God here at Pine Drive Baptist Church, if you will. God our Father, he says he's the father to the fatherless. How does he do that? How is he the father to the fatherless? Through your hands, feet, and voice. Through your hands, feet, and voice. He said, that's how I'm going to do this. That's how I'm going to feed the people. That's how I'm going to provide for the widows and how I'm going to provide for the orphans. Even though I say that word orphans, I know we got Miss Becky sitting over here. It's got two, adopted two, one from China and one from Russia. Single parent, sacrifice. And not only sacrifice, but raising those children to love the Lord our God. This is what James is talking about here. And don't miss this. He also says, obeying God's appeal demands more than an occasional visit. Oh, don't miss this. That's why I put it there in your outline. James says, obeying God's appeal demands more than an occasional visit. It demands genuine compassion. Genuine compassion and a true engagement. In other words, I'm going to be seeking them out. And when I seek them, when I see their need, I'm going to do whatever God wants me to do. Whatever he wants me to do. And the first thing we should do is to pray for them, because God's going to provide when he sees our heart. He's looking for your heart. He's looking for my heart. And then he's going to use us in ways that we cannot even begin to imagine. We're almost out of time, so let me stop here, and we'll pick this up next week on the third indicator of true religion, if you will, the clear separation from the ways of the world. We've looked at the controlled speech that displays our changed heart, the sacrificial care for those that are in need. And I want to look next week when he talks about stay away from the world. Separate yourself from the world. For some, that's not too difficult to do because they're trying to separate themselves from us, but we're getting caught in, Christians are getting caught into the world, and they're having difficulty seeing who the true followers of Jesus Christ really are. But we'll pick that up next week, if you will. I want to say this again as we go before the Lord with his invitation. After I put this message together, I was very troubled by it. I was troubled by it because of who I'm looking at this morning. Because I know what you are. I know who you are. I know what you've done. I know what you're doing. But if you can take this word of God and maybe share it with a loved one, maybe share it with a child or an adult child, someone who is hurting, then this message is for you, yes, for me, yes, But let that message, let God's word, I just happen to believe, you may have heard, it's like reading a verse of scripture. You read it 100 times, you can quote it, and all of a sudden you read it the 101st time, and all of a sudden, I never saw that before. Maybe this is what God has intended for this message that he provided this morning. But I pray that we instill into the people, this is serious business. This is not a game. It was not a game for Jesus Christ to go to the cross. It was not a game to be crucified. It was not a game when God was looking for that heart that he could focus on to be able to use. This is deathly business. And it's a business of where we will spend eternity. So I pray, as I've said before, I pray that when we see someone who is hurting, I even feel guilty right now because this just flashed in my mind. Maybe it was the Holy Spirit. Pat and I went up to get the donuts for the church this morning, and just a block from where we got the donuts, there was this most pitiful looking woman that I've ever seen. And I thought to myself, I got donuts here. Why don't I stop? Or why don't I go back and get some kolaches or something? But I didn't. I came to church. How many times you see somebody like that? I want you to bow your head with me in prayer for just this moment. Heavenly Father God, your word is not only living and active, but the Holy Spirit that lives in us is pointing people out to us. And sometimes I ignore them. God, they're on our street corners. God, they're in our neighborhoods. They're even in our churches. People are hurting. People are hungry. So, Father, we ask it, God, that you would continue to make this church here at Pine Drive what you want it to be. And that's us, Lord. That's the people. And Father, I pray that if there's one person here today or one person that hears this message and they are not saved, God, this is a decision, the biggest decision that will ever be made. And that is, where are they going to spend eternity? In heaven with you, in heaven with many loved ones, or in hell where there's pain and suffering unending, there's fire unending, there's darkness unending. Why God? Why would somebody choose that? So, Father, for someone here that needs to ask Jesus Christ to come into their heart right now at this moment, Father, let them just simply pray, Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I have not been saved, but I'm asking you to come into my heart and save me right now based on what you have done on the cross with your Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus, come in by your blood. Oh God, I pray that you forgive me of my sin, the sin that you know I'm doing right now, Lord. And you would forgive me, God, and take all these things away from me. I want to be called a Christian, and I want to be called a follower of Jesus Christ. And I'm not sure how to do that, but I'm praying right now in faith. Or I have more questions than I can even begin to ask in this prayer. God, I'm asking you to save me right now. And I believe, because I have asked and because you have seen my sincere heart, that I have been saved by the precious blood of Jesus Christ at this moment. And I will walk out of here today. When my time comes to face you, I will hear those words, Well done, good and faithful servant, come in to your rest. God, I want that. And I thank you that now that is That is my destiny. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Father God, if there's someone here today that is really, really in need of prayer, don't let them be embarrassed, God. Let them come forward. Let them come forward and just bow a knee here at the altar and pray. Or Lord, just come to me here at the basin and let me pray for them and with them, Lord. God, there are folks that need a touch of the Word of God that you provide through prayer. Lord, there may be someone who maybe is within the sound of my voice is looking for a church home where they can be ministered to, they can grow, they can serve, maybe they can heal. Whatever it is, God, this is your invitation from Almighty God who wrote this living and active and inerrant word. This is your invitation, God. And you and your Son, Jesus Christ, are waiting right now at the throne of grace in heaven for our response. And the Holy Spirit is even praying for our response right now. Father, this is your word. This is your invitation. And we respond in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. Would you stand as...